선생님이 가지고 계신 그동안의 경험을 가지고 우리에게 주시는 이 내용을 한번 1시간 반 정도 되는데요. 잘 들어보시고 또 저도 같이 아마 동참을 해서 어떤 부분이 있는지 한번 보겠습니다. So, let me introduce Ed Park. It is we on behalf of our KAAM, we would like to welcome you, and I hope you have enjoyed so far. But the audience here is very eager to know what kind of talk that you're going to present, and it would be a good opportunity to share with you your deep knowledge. Thank you very much. 네, 박수 좀 한번 부탁합니다. 네.
Thank you very much. So I am just going to say I may look Korean, but I was born in the United States. So 저 미국에서 태어났으니까 한국말 형편 없어요. 좀 너무 불편해가지고 그렇게 안 하려고 그랬는데요. But I only came here for 12 weeks in 87. And I studied Korean for only 12 weeks. So think of me as like a white person or a black person. And then you'll think, wow, he speaks Korean pretty well. So, but in our family, 우리 집안에서 한국말 전혀 안 썼어요. 그러니까 대학교 때만 석 달 동안 그게밖에 못 배웠습니다. All right. So thank you everybody for coming out. Brandon, where's Brandon? Is going to translate live, and I'm going to try and wait at the end of every slide so everyone can get caught up. And hopefully you'll find this interesting, and it might not run the whole 90 minutes, but there'll be plenty of time for questions at the end. Okay? Okay. Thank you for the wonderful introduction also. I understood a little of it. So. Okay. This talk is entitled, There is only one disease with many faces, telomere erosion, and my hope is to convince you that I'm right. The talk will include a lot of different speculation, and we'll start off with my story, who I am, my journey, how I came to learn about telomeres, and then I'm going to describe in the beginning my stem cell theory of aging, why I think there's only one disease. This will require us to then go into my experience with a telomerase activator called cycloestrogenol, after which you'll be interested to hear my clinical experience with many of my patients, which are quite unbelievable, and then we'll talk about what the scientific literature shows. There's 20,000 articles about telomeres. I understand about 6 weeks ago there was a show in Korea about telomeres, so this is a very, very active area of research. And then finally, I'd like to open it up to questions. So if you will be so kind, there is a slide number in the bottom right. If you have a question about a slide, please write that down, and we can easily find that at the end. This first slide is called From Pyongyang to Practice, and that's because both my mother and father were born in North Korea. After World War II, they came south, as I'm sure did many people. And that's a picture of him on the right. My father, Dr. Won-suk Park, went to Yonsei, and he graduated in 56. And apparently, he had only 8 months of high school. He did all the entrance exams by himself because at that time, they didn't have enough money to afford a good school. But he was accepted into Seoul, and then his father recommended, for religious reasons, that he go to Yonsei instead. After serving in the military, he went to the United States and met my mother in Philadelphia during his residency. We were emigrated to Canada, where my brother and I were born. And the picture on the bottom right shows in 1983, my sister graduating from Harvard, and we were lucky enough, my brother and then myself in the sunglasses, to follow. And I studied anthropology there. Followed by a medical degree at Columbia in New York City, and at the same time, a degree in public health. I then returned to Harvard Medical School's Beth Israel to study OBGYN and practice clinical OBGYN in Southern California from 97 to about 2010. In 2004, my father was diagnosed with brain cancer. Most people in this audience are medical doctors. Can I see who's a medical doctor? Would you please raise your hand? I just want to make sure I can explain in a medical term without having confusion. So he was very healthy until 72. He was diagnosed with a glioblastoma and then had surgery, external radiation twice, immunotherapy, a bunch of oral chemotherapy, and unfortunately he passed away at 74. And I was there when he took his last breath, and the last year of his life was very difficult. The treatment had robbed him of most of his ability to even think, let alone express or take care of himself. And of course, this when this happens in your family, it's very different. So as a relatively young person, I never worried about aging. People don't generally worry about aging until perhaps it's too late. And so I started to look, as everyone can look, on the internet, why do people age? Because I have a medical and a public health degree, I perhaps could understand it a little easier, but the answers are there for us. And what we see, unfortunately, is in science and in product sales, everybody has their own theory: oxidation, mitochondria, methylation. They even talk about evolutionary reasons for aging, or they talk about pet chemical pathways, little minute pathways like mTOR or ROS or FOXO. But I look at it differently. I like to keep it simple. So if we look at what Mother Nature really has shown us in terms of premature or accelerated aging, it seems to be a problem, not of all these little pathways, but of general DNA handling. If we see the gentleman, he's probably only 13, he's very close to the end of his life because of accelerated premature aging called progeria. And when you do a chart of the known progeric syndromes, what we find here is that the top half, the telomeres, are all shortened. And the common theme here is DNA repair in red, DNA transcription in yellow below, although telomeres are not shortened. We have problems with scaffolding for DNA. Telomerase itself is one of the classic premature aging syndromes, and helicase, which is an enzyme for winding and unwinding the DNA. This is what real life accelerated aging shows. So for example, in the green one, dyskeratosis congenita, you only have one good copy of the key used to drive telomerase, and these kids will die at 13 of old age. If we all have two good copies, 75 maybe. But what if we could put multiple copies or make those copies more efficient? That's really what we're moving at. So you listen to a lot of people say aging is this pathway or that pathway. Just remember, they're doing research to publish to get their careers advanced. Is that really the fundamental reason why we age? Or maybe they're just selling something. So the big question is, aging appears to be a genetic integrity problem. But how does this relate to our immortal stem cells? We know that stem cells, because of telomerase, one of the two characteristics of their stemness is that they're immortal. They re-lengthen their telomeres. They run millions, billions of copies. The other, for those that are interested, characteristic of stemness is that they divide asymmetrically. In other words, they make a perfect mother copy and then a more differentiated daughter copy. I want to use an analogy here. As doctors, we spend many years studying the differences between everything. That's why we're experts. That's why a patient comes to us and looks something on the internet. They're not automatically right because they just read it 5 minutes ago. We spend so many years learning differences that we get a little wrapped up in that. And I'd like to explain that. When we look at planets, for example, Venus, the second planet from the sun, it rotates so slowly that one day to turn and face the sun, it takes 243 of our Earth days. But to go around the sun, it takes only 223. So a day is actually longer than a year on that planet. Uranus, they believe, was knocked, so it actually rotates on its side. And it takes 84 years to circle the sun. Again, interesting, but what does that really teach us about the solar system? If you look at this model of the solar system, you wouldn't automatically presume there are different reasons for every planet moving. It really wouldn't be logical to assume that a different force makes every planet go around. We would look for one idea, such as gravity. So the real crux of my talk is this slide. What we have in reality is that we are obsessed with everything on the outside here as doctors. We worry about central nervous system, Alzheimer's, cardiovascular disease, macular degeneration, weak immune system, accumulation of cancer, arthritis, wrinkles, infertility, menopause, diabetes. But what if, when we look from the organ level to the stem cell level, we see these are just specific stem cells. These are beta cells in the pancreas. These are retinal cells and macular degeneration. What we're seeing here is that the process appears to be the same, and it appears to originate in the core, which is the shortening of telomeres. And I will explain this a little more elegantly later. But what if we're just looking at the shortening of the telomeres, which then causes DNA and chromosome damage, which then faces the stem cell with a crisis, either to undergo senescence, dysfunction, or to undergo cell death? And then what if what we're looking at is just a depletion of our stem cells as we go through life? Now, in 2007, my father had passed away, and I was thinking, well, what a fascinating thing, these telomeres. They seem like they could explain something more fundamental about not just aging, but disease. And then I actually became very interested, and the next year, after writing a scientific fiction, a sci-fi screenplay about a future where people don't age, the company said that they had a product that was developed over years to activate telomeres. So I was very interested to try this. And at that time, it was about $33,000 to fly out to New York three times and try this thing they called TA, or Telomerase Activator 65. Now, for me, in my 20s and 30s, going to deliver babies at night is very stressful, raising a family. So I went into what we know as metabolic syndrome, high glucose resistance, fatty liver, hypercholesterolemia. And that's a picture of me at 33, but that could have been a picture of me at 29 or 35. I was about 10 kilos heavier. Now, after starting this telomerase activator, in 3 months I had lost about 8 kilos without any diet or exercise. So the patients who came back to see me for their annual exams would say, well, how is this? You look like a different person. And I didn't say anything for a year. I wanted to make sure it was safe. But then after a year, I said, well, this looks safe and people want to try it. So I applied to be the first doctor outside the company to sell it. And I became number one. And at that time, for the licensing and all the special testing equipment, it was $60,000. But I have never been a paid spokesman. I don't get money to speak on their behalf. I do sell it because it's a product that I do believe. But as you can see, me at 33, 43, and now this past summer, my one-year-old on the left is now 16, almost 17 years old. I don't feel, even without special diet or exercise, that I'm getting any older. And I think that is something that will interest a lot of people, not only in this room, but your patients and people in general. So I call what I've been doing since 2008 telomerase activation medicine. I've had over 1,000 patients. I blog 3 times a week, and I've done over 500 blogs. And when my patients call me and say, doctor, you name it, blood pressure, diabetes, got better, I'll wait until 2 or 3 people tell me the same thing, and then we do these webinars, these 50-minute to an hour webinars about what is the disease, what is the relationship to telomeres, and then do live interviews with these people. And they're incredible, although anecdotal, types of stories. I've had over 300,000 views on YouTube, and this is just a few of these 130 videos. Some of them are full length webinars, live webinars on hypertension, depression, sports injury, cancer. And then from all this experience, I decided to self-publish a book called Telomere Time Bombs, and that's shown on the bottom right. This year, I've been contracted to write a new book, which will be somewhat like this lecture, looking at the science and looking at what we know from common sense and trying to join the two and say, well, we know that exercise, we know all these things are good for telomeres, here's why, and try and just unite these two communities. Because the doctors and the scientists in their labs will do 20,000 more articles, and the people listening to the news or reading the popular literature, they don't really understand. So my goal here, I think, is to make that literature something that doctors and patients can use and understand. What we have here is a picture of actual telomeres. Now, those are chromosomes, as you'll recognize, and then the tips are stained to fluoresce, and they are the yellow telomeres. Telomere was named by Hermann Muller in America, and it was 1932 when he guessed correctly the function. And he guessed that they were probably a cap to prevent it from being damaged or recognized as a damage, like an X-ray break in the chromosome. We know about the centromeres, which are used to pull apart the chromosomes. Those are the center bodies. The end bodies, the telomeres, are also critically important, not just to protect, but they're also used as handlers. So there are various times when they're used to immobilize the end of the chromosome. They're present in all eukaryotes, and in fact, all cells which have a nucleus require these because they don't have circular DNA like bacteria. We know that it's important to have telomeres because animals all share the same code, TTAGGG, repeating over and over again. Plants have one more letter in there. They have another T. Insects have one less, TTAGG. And Candida has this incredibly long code, but it's just nonsense code. It's repeating. And so it's like an old blank tape leader. It just, it doesn't matter. It's not coding DNA. This is my stem cell telomere theory of aging. And the reason I put up this cartoon from my book is to illustrate the emperor's new clothes. As you may know, there was a story from Europe that the emperor was walking around with beautiful new clothes, and everyone said, my God, what beautiful clothes, when in fact he was naked, and only one boy could see it, because everyone else assumed that why would everyone else believe it if it wasn't true? And the reason why I use this analogy is because my theory is four axioms, or four suppositions, rules, and then a hypothesis. And nothing in the axioms is at all controversial. So I'd like to review those with you. The first axiom is that end replication, it causes primer gaps. You can't start copying from the very end of the chromosome. So every time a mother divides into two daughters, the two daughters have lost 50 to 100 base pairs. This is a rule. You just can't copy to the end. There is not a scientist in the world that would consider this to be at all controversial. Number two axiom, non-stem cell lines that don't have the telomerase that we'll discuss, they undergo what's called replicative senescence. That's a very important word. Replicative means by copying, and senescence means they get old. This is fundamental to what I believe is the problem with aging and disease. So this illustration from my book portrays a chromosome as this double-stranded helix that we know, but it has four firecrackers on the end, and the fuses are always burning. Now, what happens when the ends burn down to the firecracker is trouble, and this is illustrated by this wonderful graph, which is basically the Hayflick limit illustrated. On the bottom x-axis, you see the number of cell divisions, 10, 20, 30. It's known that where these curves cross, about 40 to 60, what we're seeing here is that the mamas are copying over and over again, and the telomeres are shortening and shortening. Eventually, this dashed line, the percentage of aneuploid, or not the correct chromosome number, is going up. And commensurate with that, the number of cells in the colony goes down. These are related concepts. If you have no telomerase in differentiated non-stem cells, this is what you have eventually. You have a shortening of your chromosomes, a mutation, and then you have non-viability of the colony. The third axiom is that a daughter can only be as young or as healthy as her mother. It makes sense from what we know of DNA copying. The daughter isn't going to make up new DNA or refer back to mom's original ancestral DNA. So the youth, if you will, or the telomere length, is copied from the mom. Now, we do know from Dolly the sheep that when Dolly was cloned, they didn't reset that counter, so Dolly was born old. Now, in the new technology that won the Nobel Prize a few years ago, induced pluripotent stem cells, scientists have found ways to trigger three genes and cause the actual stem cell, or actually regular cell, to become stem-like. And in that process, you get a reset, a re-lengthening of the chromosome, which is, of course, what happens when you have your babies. Your babies are not born as old as you are. They get that reset from that primitive de-differentiation. But it's important to realize that a daughter can only be as young or as healthy as her mother. So health, in this bottom instance, let's say we have a perfect photocopy, and then we photocopy it over and over and over again. Well, what happens? You get streaks, blurs, errors, rotation. Again, at some low level, probably just a couple of base pairs, there's probably mutation going on in our DNA code. So our DNA is not getting any better. Now, a subject I'd like to talk about, which I can't at this because of time, is epigenetics. Now, not only does the DNA code get copied from the mom, but the epigenetics also gets copied, the methylation, the acetylation. That's like the software, if you will, in the cell. And there's a point in the cell cycle where that's copied too. So daughter will get some of mom's bad habits as well, not just her physical genetic endowment. The last axiom is that stem cells use telomerase to preserve themselves. If you didn't know a lot about telomerase, these two illustrations will kind of make it clear. Many years ago, we used to make labels with these label makers. We'd type out and then we'd make a sticker for our locker or our notebook. That's what it is. It's a reverse transcriptase, meaning reverse from RNA into DNA, and it makes this re-lengthening possible of the telomeres. Or if you will, if you're really old, you might remember stock ticker symbols. This is something in the 20s and 30s they used to get this tape running out. Now, bottom is the illustration of the actual DNA. Here's the chromosome, and here's the DNA and the telomere, TTAGGG, TTAGGG, and it gets into this red thing, which is the telomerase, human telomerase reverse transcriptase. This requires the green thing, which is the TERC, RNA component. Okay, so this is like the printer, and this is the printing press, if you will. So the opposite of TTAGGG is here, and you can actually cause a typographical error in that TTAGGG, so they know exactly where it is. And then this purple blob is called discarin, and the reason it's interesting is because the TERC hairpin here has to be modified, we think, in order for the discarin to fit right. So if you will, the red is the engine, the green TERC is the key, and the purple discarin is the keyhole. So if the corkscrew is modified properly, it will fit the discarin and the active site will be available and you can start printing away. Oh, and discarin is the molecule that is involved in dyskeratosis congenita. That was what that prematurely aged boy had. So finally, what follows from these four axioms is a hypothesis, which is maybe aging is caused by the shortening of telomeres in stem cells and the gradual depletion of our stem cell reserve. If stem cells and their telomeres can be protected by telomerase activation, then the effects of aging may be slowed and possibly reversed. And in fact, you may know in 2009, the discovery of telomerase, which happened decades earlier, got the Nobel Prize. Well, 2 years later, this gentleman from Harvard, his lab proved this hypothesis, and he was attempting to prove the opposite, actually. But he engineered mice to be telomerase inadequate, reintroduced the ability in subsequent generations. The mice, to his great surprise, got younger. neurologically, their coats got darker. In every way, he had proven this hypothesis that telomerase activation is able to rejuvenate. He made a lot of press, and but you know, you would think an important discovery like this would be of great interest, but they treat it as another story like any other story, and he moved on in his career. Now I'd like to take a break here and play a little game, if you will, and I'd like you to find somebody that you're next to, and I'd like you to tell them, ideally, how long you would like to live, about when you would like to die. So if you would please take a moment, I'll have a drink. Just introduce yourself to somebody and give them a number. What age is the perfect number to die? And no, please tell somebody next to you, if you wouldn't mind, I'll have a drink. Didn't introduce yourselves, but I'd like to know, put your hand up, okay? Everybody, please raise your hand if you'd like to live till this Christmas. Everybody wants to be nuked by Kim Jong-un? Is that what's going on? Not a good audience participation crowd. All right. Who wants to live only till 80? 80, okay, 80. We got some takers on 80. Good. Going once, going twice. How about 100? All right. 100. Pek Yan Buihayo. 120. 120. Oh, 욕심도 많으시네요. Okay, 120. How about 150? That's my guy over there. Now, this is a famous Korean older lady here. I think, though, you have the right answer, as long as I'm healthy. That is the best answer. So the question that Hamlet asked here, Sir Laurence Olivier, to be or not to be, it's actually a very important question. Do we want to live? And when I ask doctors in other lectures, most people start putting their hands down around 90, 100, because they assume as you get older, you'll start looking like this harabaji or this old lady. But what if I were to decouple that and say to you, no, the people in this Christmas photo are 150 years old. Well, that would change your feeling about how old you want to live. So actually, the question of our mortality, to be or not to be, is always around. And it's one that is incredibly important to consider. So my job in this little section of the talk is to try and convince you that we can be immortal. So to do that, I'm going to ask you to learn a mantra. Does anybody know what a mantra is? I'm sure you all do. It's like a repeated sound or phrase from India. So please say this with me. Volvo, lobster, Gila, tart. Okay? Volvo, lobster, thank you. Gila, tart. Good. Once again, 다시 한번. Volvo, lobsters, Gila, tart. Good. One more time by yourselves. Volvo, Gila, tart. Okay, good. These four things have the key to how we're all going to be immortal. What we have here is a Volvo. It's a P1800 1966 beautiful roadster. And this gentleman, Irv Gordon, tells us that he has been driving and paying people to drive this ridiculous car for 3 million miles. Now, if I say to you, how is that possible? Not anybody in here would say, that's impossible. You would just say, well, he replaced the parts. Well, why couldn't we just replace our parts, right? So you'll say, well, that's just a machine. That's a Volvo. That's not a human. Well, this brings us to the delicious and fascinating immortal lobster. Now, I don't know if I believe this, but they say lobsters are immortal. This is a 19-pound or 140-year-old lobster. And indeed, it's said that about 20% of the lobster cells are stem-like, conferring upon them this telomerase activity. Now, the downside of being an immortal lobster is you get really big and people want to eat you. Also, you keep on growing, so you have to molt, which is the word for shed your exoskeleton. And it doesn't age because the telomere's activity in so many of its cells keeps it just growing and growing. But I think for most of us, we don't want to buy new clothes and new cars, so this is not the model. But indeed, you look at the giant squid, you look at turtles, there are a lot of animals that just keep on growing. And the degree of stemness may be very important, especially among invertebrates. But you might say, well, that's an invertebrate. That's not even a human. It doesn't relate to me. This is where we get to HeLa. And for those who have done bench research, HeLa stands for Henrietta Lacks, which is this woman, African-American woman, whose cancer cells are being used, patented, sold as a lab standard throughout the world for cell testing. Now, for the last 60 years, you can buy HeLa cervical cancer cells, which are immortal. And very unfortunately, you can see in the blue these cells behaving as cancer cells. But what you don't maybe realize that the chromosome number is not 2N, it's actually 3N plus. And instead of 46 chromosomes, we have 76 to 80 chromosomes. It's a totally bad system to use for lab testing, but yet it is our standard. It's so different from regular human cells that somebody proposed calling it Helaciton Gartleri. Gartler is the gentleman who was associated with using them. But you know, the truth of the matter is, as you'll realize a little later this lecture, all your cells are destined to mutate like this. If they're differentiated cells, they die, no big deal. You have sloughed off there. But if they're stem cells, then you could be looking at serious problems. You might say, well, these are cancer cells. This doesn't apply to my immortality. But you'd be wrong, because the final Volvo lobster HeLa TERT is that TERT is actually active in all your stem cells, especially if you're making eggs and sperm. What we see on the top line is that the telomere length of your eggs and sperm is quite good. In fact, in men, there's a suggestion it gets longer. Regardless, we understand that if we are just carriers of our species' DNA, every generation does not get older or sicker or smaller. There is a reset. So there is perfect immortality in our eggs and sperm. What we see on this red line is a premature aging. Let's say you had just one good copy of telomerase, dead at 13. And what we're misinterpreting on this green line is everything else, when in fact, yes, cells in your pancreas, your brain, your liver, everything is aging, but depending on how we define and measure things, maybe it's not aging in a gradual fashion. And again, my hope is to convince you that with increased telomerase activity, we can push this curve up and extend our healthy lifespan. If we move on to actual literature here, we look at Jewish centenarians, that people that lived beyond 100 years, and found that their telomerase activity was indeed higher. Telomerase activity is something that can be actively measured, and they had longer telomeres, again suggesting that even amidst people, among people that survived past 100, part of their key was the telomerase. On the bottom right, we see a scatter plot. And if you look at, there was a Kaiser Permanente study in Northern California. Right now, if you look at any population, whether it be, you know, 100, 1,000, 120,000, this is the curve. It's down. But look how wide the curve is. You have 80-year-olds and 20-year-olds overlapping. So your confidence interval is very wide. You cannot give me blood from a crime scene and tell me how old the people were. Can't be done. Now, what's interesting is even among these older people, and they like using Ashkenazi Jews because of the relative genetic homogeneity, we found that people with hypertension, metabolic syndrome, which is what I had in those fat pictures, diabetes, and their neurological scores, even amidst them, those without disease had longer telomeres, again suggesting that maybe this octagon, which looks a little bit like a Buddhist symbol from the Teguki, maybe that is what's going on everywhere. Finally, we turn to these trees. These bristlecone pines can live up to 5,000 years. how is that possible? Now, if you really look at the studies, they say that the longer-lived pine trees have more telomerase activity and longer telomeres, but it's not that simple a relationship. What is interesting is that when they looked at bristle cone pines that were 17, 180, 2,000, 3,000 years, what they didn't find is that telomerase was unopposed and unidirectional. So when you look at humans, we're all going this way. If you look at a 4,000-year-old tree, it's not like the curve gets longer and longer and longer. There is something, and granted, these are not the same trees. These are different trees. But if you look at these examples of bristlecone pines, they don't just get longer through life. It doesn't get too long. There is a regulation. Just like people can't grow their hair too long. There's a limit. So here is the key slide. This is why the talk is One Disease, Many Faces. What is the one disease? The one disease is NHAG, non-homologous end joining from critically short telomeres. What does that mean? That's just a fancy of saying non-homologous, meaning the ends of a chromosome that has melted down, it's naked, it's recognized by the cell machinery as a DNA double-strand break, we think. So if you are walking around and an X-ray hits you and the chromosome is cut, it turns out there's a lot of policemen looking around for these cuts, and when they notice them, they sew it back together. Very important. So what happens when the chromosome gets too short is that the machinery thinks it's cut and it sews it to somebody. So just like these two trapeze artists, the ends of the chromosomes get stuck to each other. And the next time that cell divides, both chromosomes might go to one daughter with none on the other. That's how Henrietta Lacks got 76 chromosomes. Division, and then they went one side and maybe not the other. But what happens also is that they tear not just, they don't necessarily stay double. They can tear, let's say, at the arms or the wrists, and that's what's shown here, partial tears. So this is the process at work all the time in your cells. If they're differentiated cells, like what will become te in the Mogyoktang, we don't care, they die. But if this non-homologous end joining and subsequent mutation occurs in stem cells, we do have a problem. Now what is the result of this? So we discussed the tears, we discussed the abnormal karyotypes. The mediator, where the rubber meets the road, as we say in the United States, is P53. P53 is a very mysterious enzyme which is involved with checking for DNA problems, chromosome problems specifically. And in conjunction with something called the spindle activation checkpoint, when the chromosomes are lined up in metaphase to divide, there's a number check. You know, is everyone here? Is everyone in the right number? If that check is not okay, then the signal is given to P53 to murder itself. The cell kills itself. This is not a bad thing, this is a good thing. And this happens all the time. This is part of life. So how it does that is by poking a bunch of holes in the mitochondria, and the mitochondria leak battery acid, and the thing melts like the Wicked Witch of the West. This is what's going on, and it's why people have mistaken oxidation and mitochondrial dysfunction as the reason for aging. In fact, that's just the way the cell tries to kill itself. Sure, old cells have mitochondrial dysfunction, but it's because of a proximate or an earlier recognition that we're going to kill ourselves. There's something wrong with our DNA. So if there's good news, there's one disease, then there's one cure, and the one cure is to increase our telomerase activity, which will then slow the depletion of all these blank keys. Think of the mesenchymal or mesenchymal stem cells as these blank keys. They could become nerves, bone, muscle, immune cells. You're running out of these blank keys. So the key is to keep them healthy and young until such a day as is very, very close now that we can replace our parts, just like Irv replaces his parts. So there's a day coming very soon where you will have your liposuction, and they'll save your stromal vascular stem cells. And then 20 years from now, when you're sick of your bad vision, you'll get custom differentiated retinal cells, or you'll get a new pancreas. This is going to happen, and this is the key to living 3 million years, is replacement parts. But until we get there, we need to keep what we have, our blank keys, from burning out quickly. Is everybody awake still? It's kind of hot in here. Everyone's awake? Okay, that's good. All right. This slide, I couldn't believe how cold Korea was. I didn't know it was this. 원래 한국 이렇게 추워요? It's March, right? It's supposed to be a little warmer. Well, we're lucky. We live in Southern California, so we can actually, and we've done this, go surfing, and we can go skiing in the same day. It's really a chonjang. So anyway, so here's my boys surfing, and here's us in Mammoth. And I like to say that I got very lucky to find TA65 and hopefully stay younger for them and productive. So what is TA65? Well, TA65 we think is cycloestrogenol. Where did it come from? Well, there's this famous bank robber in the US called Willie Sutton, and he's famous because they asked him, "Willie, why do you rob banks?" And he answered, "Because that's where the money is." Now, this loses something in translation, but I think what the funny part of that quote is that he was answering the obvious. Now, the reason why the company that researched this went to Huangji or Huanggi to find cycloestrogenol is because that's where the money was. For thousands of years, people had used Huanggi as a qi tonifier or qigong enhancer, and it was known to be in the heaven class of herbs or immune enhancer and longevity. So just like if you want to get an endocannabinoid like tetrahydrocannabinoid, you might go to the marijuana plant and decoct out the molecules and find out what was making people euphoric. The Geron Corporation went to Huanggi and decocted all the molecules and found which one was activating telomerase. And so they filed this patent in 2002, and it was awarded in 2000-something later. And it basically covers about 6 molecules from the Huanggi astragalus plant. And what's shown in this graph is a doubling to tripling for about 14 hours of the telomerase activity in human keratinocytes. Now, this intellectual property was then awarded or sold to the TA Sciences Corporation. We think it's cycloestrogenol because of the patent filings, the FDA filings, and so it could be other molecules, but in terms of the literature that's been published, it's always called cycloestrogenol. Here's one of the studies looking at what telomerase activation does in a mice model. And what's interesting is these mice are engineered to age, and when you reintroduce telomerase, what you have is a decrease in the signal-free end. Signal-free is a naked, uncapped, no telomere chromosome end. You also see a decrease at 2 different concentrations of the critically shortened telomeres. And in fact, this is what I see in my practice as I measure people's telomeres. Critically shortened, of course, is here measured less than 8,000. For humans, arguably less than 3,000. So the key is, if you have a firecracker with a fuse that's that long or that long, it doesn't matter. All you care about is that it's not too short and about to be naked and then improperly combined. What is the mechanism of this cycloestrogenol? Well, in science, we have what's called a gene chip. It's as big as a postage stamp, and it has 16,000 testing wells for every single messenger RNA. When you look at what genes are upregulated, there's only about 8 of them here, and they're all involved at a low level with DNA, with cell replication. The MAPK is a protein kinase pathway, and the second study at the bottom looked at giving TA65 to cells, and they found that if you block this protein kinase pathway, the effect was reduced. So it seems to be not increased transcription of the telomerase gene, no, it's some kind of cell signaling. And in fact, the cell signaling is, MAPK is one of the downstream pathways of the endocannabinoid system. So the endocannabinoid is like the opioid system. Anesthesiologists give you heroin or some medications to mellow you out and take away pain. There's an entire another signaling system related to marijuana derivatives, cannabinoids. And so for some reason, TA65 or cycloestrogenol appears to make us happy and activate our telomerase through the MAPK pathway. This study out of UCLA looked at HIV-infected T cells, and it was fascinating to find that when you gave them cycloestrogenol, these HIV-infected T cells slowed their telomere shortening. They could proliferate more, which is a theme we'll be visiting later on. They moved better, they interacted better, and they had stronger antiviral activity. They behaved like younger, healthier cells, just like those mice in the Dipinno-Harvard study. They're just acting younger. And the important thing is that when you did a specific blockage of telomerase with telomerase inhibitor, this effect disappeared. The first 100 people, of which I was 19, were studied, and they looked at their CD8 cells. CD8 cells are the cytotoxic cells. These are the ones that are charged with killing off the cancer and the cells infected with viruses. Now, a CD8 negative means it lacks the cellular differentiation marker 28, which is present when a cell can change. If you have a blank key that's cut, you can't make a key go into any lock. It's already cut. Well, a CD28 negative cell is like a cut key. It's not good for all locks anymore. So what they found when they gave me, the customers, TA65, is that the CD28 negative fraction, or the burnt out cut keys, went way down, along with the natural killer cells, which went way down. And this was especially true in the CMV-infected population. Now, CMV, as you know, is cytomegalovirus. It infectious mononucleosis. It's part of a larger family of herpes viruses. Indeed, there was a study last week saying that perhaps even Alzheimer's is a form of herpes virus. And the reason why herpes viruses are so important is that they live chronically within our cells, especially in the dorsal root ganglia. And it's thought that fighting them helps age us. And this could be a critically important part of why our immune system and all these undifferentiated stem cells go away. So the take-home lesson is that by giving this telomerase activator, these T cells came back. Finally, when we look at the cycloestrogenol effect on metabolism, we see the same thing that happened to me on a low level in this first cohort, and they reported the first 7,000 person years of use. Of course, you know, there's a reporting bias there, so they said there were no adverse effects, largely depending on how you define an adverse effect. But what was interesting is that if you believe in this sort of thing, the p-values, then it was statistically unlikely, or less than 2% chance, that the change in fasting glucose was not real. So there was a decrease of 3.7 in the fasting glucose, a decrease in insulin of 1.3, decrease in total cholesterol and LDL, and there was also a decrease in the systolic and diastolic pressures. Finally, homocysteine, a marker of inflammation, was decreased, and bone mineral density was increased. Well, here's another take on the theme of luck. Here's me. Does anybody in here play golf? I thought Korean doctors played golf. Oh, there's one person. Okay. I didn't say you have to play well. This is me back in 2010. I had a hole-in-one, which they say is very unlikely for an amateur golfer. I've played less than 100 rounds of golf in my life. So what happens, I was walking with my two Korean buddies one morning. There was no wind, so it wasn't luck. It didn't hit a tree or a squirrel. And I bounced the ball to 8 inches, and it went right in. So I thought, great. Well, they say that's 5 years good luck. Well, luckily, this year I've been so busy, last year, I hadn't hit a golf ball for a year. And I went back out to our club with my friend, and he said to me, isn't this where you got your hole-in-one? I said, yeah, this is. So I said, well, to myself, I just do what I did last time. And for one pure moment, I actually believed it. And so I struck the ball. Again, this is like, you know, the 18th or 17th hole, but I hadn't played golf for a year. And this thing went right in the hole, straight in the hole. So I guess I missed. I was meaning to do it 8 inches, but nevertheless, I think I'm good, hopefully, for another 5 years. So is there that superstition that if you have a hole in one, it's good luck? I think so. I think you have to buy drinks, so we'll have to see. Anyway, just trying to keep everyone awake. 여러분들 좀 안 주무시죠? 좀 괜찮으시겠어요? 이해하시겠어요? Everyone's understanding? Okay, good. All right, so I want to turn now to a concept called adaptogens, or lokahi. Now, I found this word because I realized that the changes I was seeing in my patients wasn't just like a blockage or a medical effect. It depended on the person. If a person was too heavy, they might eat less. If they were too skinny, they would eat more. And if they slept 10 hours, they might sleep 8. If they slept 6, they might sleep 8. So I said to myself, what kind of thing causes a different effect in different people? And this is the concept, which is sort of a fringe concept of medicine called an adaptogen, something that causes a different effect depending on what your body needs. And then I started to look for words in Indian or Chinese or any language that would explain this concept. And the one I found was Hawaii, which is, in Hawaii they have this concept called lokahi, which means balance and flow. So things are moving, there's movement, activity, flow, but it's also balance. And that doesn't mean that things are perfectly balanced like a seesaw, it just means that you're not rejecting it. So we know as doctors that when people are stressed, they're not in flow, they're obsessed with something, right? You've seen a person get cancer after their spouse, well, it wasn't necessarily contagious, there's just so much stress. They get locked up, there's no flow, and there's no balance. So indeed, fear can be a cause of disease, as can many different kinds of lack of flow. And as we learn more about the endocannabinoid system, perhaps that's really where the money is for health. Perhaps for longevity, the money was in Huangji. Maybe something in the cannabinoid system, as they're learning, is helping people to cure cancer or become high on life, if you will. Now, the importance of an adaptogenic model means that we look at life as integration, as function. We don't just look at it like, well, you're genetically going to get this because your parents had it. We're all optimized to actually be healthy and functioning. But what's wrong with the Western model? The Western model, if you look here at hypertension, for example, yes, wonderful. We've reduced it to angiotensinogen, angiotensin 1, 2, and then we have the receptors which are blocked, and then they come out and they give us pens and tell us to sell their new angiotensin receptor blocker. But the question is this really getting at the root cause of hypertension? It's just blocking a pathway. And we know that when we block a pathway, there's going to be repercussions, there's going to be consequences. And that's why so many of the drugs that we prescribe beget or cause new problems, which need new drugs. When we take hormones, like for example, this gentleman might take testosterone, we have another misconception. We're taking testosterone, but look at the side effects, the testicular atrophy. So again, the goal of an adaptogen is not to overload the system with the end product, because that will cause ramifications. So whenever you introduce a blocker or a surplus of a hormone, there are going to be effects. Now, what is the mechanism of action of cycloestrogenol? Now, this is something that you can read about in my book. I hypothesize, or I suggest that maybe there are at least 4 different ways. The first would be, obviously, if there's prevention of decay from this lengthening, we're going to get cells that stick around longer or that last longer. Secondly, we have accelerated cell copying. We see very commonly people who are taking telomerase activators, their skin just heals so much faster. So it's a good adjunct for actually plastic surgery. In addition, there's a stochastic effect, which is meant to illustrate meant to be illustrated by these two men on bikes. The young man, if you give him a bike, will go faster than the old man. So a lot of it depends on, if you have a liver that's half diseased with hepatitis and cancer, it won't benefit as much as a young liver. But what we do see in the stochastic sense is that you have an increased organ function. So let's say your liver is made up of a bunch of different niches or stem cell kingdoms. We find that when you take a telomerase activator, it's hard to get hungover. I heard the word the other night when I was at dinner with Lucia. What is it, the word for hangover? Surcha? Suchi? No, but that hangover the next day, yeah. So it's very hard to get hungover when you, because the liver processes the alcohol so quickly, the alcohol dehydrogenase. Finally, there's a very important apoptotic mechanism, I believe, and this can only be explained by killing off the bad queen, and she's getting replaced. So that is why, you know, the fat cells in my visceral fat went away, and even though I didn't take any TA or thing for like 8-9 months, I couldn't gain weight back. So that can only be explained with an apoptosis mechanism. It wasn't a metabolic or maybe a placebo. Something died and was replaced by a younger version. So again, if you're a 16-year-old kid, you eat pizza, you don't expect to get fat. You're a 45-year-old guy, you eat pizza, you know, you're gonna feel inflamed and sick. And that's part of how our system is changing over time. I've also given TA to my son when he sprains a ligament playing volleyball and can heal within 2 or 3 days. Recently gave it to my yoga instructor who tore his knee, his medial collateral. Within 3 weeks, he was back to full. So again, I suggest that there's multiple mechanisms, but the only way, which is common among my patients, that they get these aches right after starting, and then the pain is gone forever, something they could have injured in high school, it can only be explained with an apoptotic effect. So I submit that there are these cells throughout your body that are damaged, but they're not doing the right thing. They're not killing themselves. They are staying senescent or active, sort of like 60-year-old civil service employees. Finally, there's other what we call non-canonical actions, meaning non-reverse transcriptase reactions that are involved with mitochondria signaling. And so telomerase is kind of mysterious in that it acts in other ways besides just lengthening your stem cell DNA. If you go to YouTube, you can find my channel, Dr. Park 65, and if you go to my website, rechargebiomedical.com, you can see my blog, which does tend to stray into some very strange topics. This week I blogged about this Paduk tournament with Google's machine. I like to think about the future because I think I have a long future now. So I get a little bit into politics, a little bit into robots and economy. But the world is changing very quickly, and I think that what we're starting to realize is that we need to plan for a future when we're all around healthy for a very long time. And I think that's the paradigm shift that we're seeing in so many things. It's not us versus them or humans versus robots or rich versus poor. Even what we're looking at, and I was discussing this with Lucia's husband, who's the president of the Korean Development Bank, we're looking at a situation where we're going to work towards a future where everyone can coexist in a long and healthy way on this earth. So I think that's really what part of this is, a small part of the puzzle. When a person lives 73 meager years, they don't have time to be good. But just like living in a small town, if you live in a small town, people have good manners. Because, you know, if you lie and you are a bad person, no one will want to be with you. Well, same with lifespan. If you're going to live in this small town, this spaceship Earth, for 300 years, you can't afford to be doing bad things to everybody. So I think that actually the paradigm of longevity will change human nature for the better, and that people will become more accountable and more moral. And that's why if you do go subscribe to my blogs, you'll see I discuss a lot of weird things, not just telomere related, although that is the focus. I do discuss telomerase a lot. On YouTube, I have 5,000, I have over 300,000 views of these videos, and a lot of them do just pertain to clinical medicine. I really am the only doctor doing telomerase activation medicine, so I guess I would be the president of this whole organization and its only member. But hopefully I can convince some of you to become interested in this crazy idea that the emperor has no clothes. So again, I do know that we need disease-focused clinical trials. We need lab studies, and this is not science. This is anecdotal, and so it's very important as we talk about this, clinical changes, that you understand these are just stories that I'm collecting, but that doesn't necessarily make them false. It just makes them something that requires further investigation. So at this point, I'd like us all to just take a deep breath. So if we could, 좀 토니까 좀 can you just, everybody stand up and we'll do some deep breathing just for a little bit, please? So, 다들 여러분들 일어나시고 바랍니다. So we're going to breathe a few times. Because this next part, believe me, you're going to say, oh, 기가 막히게, I don't, 못 믿겠어. 이 새끼 놈이 무슨 거짓말하고 있는. So let's just, I'll take a deep breath, okay? 하나, 둘, 셋, we're going to inhale. Let's hold it. And exhale. I like in the old, they always do the 회사, they do the morning workout. Okay, let's do it. Ta-da. Hold it. And breathe. Oh, feels good. Okay, 다시 한 번. Breathe. Good. 마지막 time. Breathe. Good. I feel better. I hope you feel better too. Thank you. So I think actually the whole telomere thing is not as important as just breathing. I realize that that is the real key to staying alive for a long time. Here's one of my patients and friends, Martin, who is 71, and he can do like 20 pull-ups. I just thought I'd share that with you. It's kind of fun. He can also bench press 127 kilos at 71. I love watching the guys in the background on the video. You can see they're just staring at him like they just can't believe it. And that's really, the great thing about Marty is he almost died as a result of Western medical intervention. He had a complication from a surgery, and then he was given so many drugs that made him crazy and suicidal. And he finally came back and said, enough, I'm going to do natural things. And so he's so healthy, he composes beautiful music on the piano that's like Aaron Copland, and it's just, he couldn't be happier about getting older at 71. So I think that's really what we're talking about here, is living a long and healthy life. So in my clinical experience over the last years, these are the things that I've noticed. First of all, in sleep, mood, and focus, there is an immediate improvement. You usually get deeper and more restful sleep, and the dreaming is very vivid. So people describe it as, it's like I'm in it. It's like I can't tell what reality is in my dream. So that's very interesting. And indeed, I use it as a heuristic, which is a practical, empirical method of knowing if something's working, right? So I have people take this at night, and if their dreaming is different, and if they have these middle of night awakenings, I can adjust the dosage. Another common thing is people's mood is better, and that could be functional. It's because they're getting better sleep, but also they tend to work out a lot of their anxieties in their dreams. So people will say, well, I'm like the hero of my dream, and there's a lot of interesting subconscious stuff that happens. The libido can be improved oftentimes. And what we find is that people have a better time coping. They have less obsessive, anxious thinking in their daily lives. People say, oh, stuff that used to bother me doesn't. And so that's really interesting, and it goes back to what I'm talking about flow or lokahi. Memory is better, thinking, focus, and a very interesting thing happens with like a defragmentation of the mind. And I think you can see this as you dream. You start to dream about things you haven't thought about for 30 years. I believe it's because the memories are being reorganized, defragmented, like a hard drive. And it's very interesting. At this point, after 8 years of taking telomerase activators, my memory is all RAM. I mean, I can remember things that happened to me as a child visiting Korea 30 something years ago like it happened yesterday. So it's a very interesting thing that happens to memory. And finally, we've noticed the benefit of decreased drug addictions, decreased psychoactive things like alcohol, caffeine, and I believe that has to do with relearning. As we sleep, when we find out all these celebrities that die of sleep dysfunction, it's because they don't get good sleep. The sleep medications interfere with the normal deep sleep, slow wave sleep, and REM sleep. So what we see is that we get an upward spiral. It's hard to know what causes all these good changes. Is it the sleep? Is it the mood? Is it the self-image? But instead of a downward spiral, we get an upward spiral. And that leads to better relationships, hope, confidence. So it just improves everything. And so I do think that adaptogens, they work in mysterious ways. And I always like to say, they don't do anything. They say, doctor, what will it do to me? I don't know what's wrong with you. I need to get to know you. So the effects are very particular to the people and what's out of balance for them. What's a little more tangible is, for example, you get a higher aerobic capacity. The gentleman on the left, Hannes, is 62. He couldn't wait to turn 60 because what happened was, as a 58-year-old, he was okay, but as a 60-year-old, he was a gold medalist. And in fact, the physician on the right from Hawaii, Greg, he can't wait to turn 60 because, again, he noticed within weeks, 2 weeks, his ocean swimming times went down 15%. For some reason, there was just better aerobic capacity. For people who like to lift weights, like our friend Marty there, they can recover without tearing joints and ligaments. And so the muscle load is accompanied by rebuilding, right? And so Guy, who was an actor there, he actually won a North American powerlifting contest at the age of 43. So these people are really enjoying better life at ages where we thought this would not be possible. Clinically speaking, we see that skin is better. There's just better elasticity. We have one of the machines I purchased to do the patent protocol is elastometer, and it pulls on the skin and sees what percentage the skin pulls back. And we generally do see quite significant improvement in the skin elasticity. Nails particularly grow harder and faster, and the hair also grows faster. Skin can heal quite quickly. And in addition, we see some interesting changes in some of the aging phenotypes. Actinic keratoses can sometimes go away, and the frequency of basal cell epitheliomas, clinically speaking, decreases. Most people really love this picture of Soledad, who lived close by, and she's 112 years old when I came to her and gave her the TA, or the cyclo. And what's really interesting is, as described in my webinar, she grew a couple of hundred black hairs. She had not had black hairs for 40 years. And for some reason, people like that story, even though it's not that uncommon. I'd say about 20-30% get repigmentation of hair. In fact, I used to have black hairs, and I do not up here. I have a couple on my chin, and I'll be 49, well, 50, 한국 나이로, Korean age. So, and I used to need reading glasses, and I don't anymore. So it's interesting, a lot of things we associate with getting old, loss of elasticity in the lens, which causes the presbyopia. Again, don't consider these irreversible. Just like the mice at Harvard, they can get younger. Clinically, the circulation is interesting. There's a patient who's 81, who's for the last 4 years, since 77, has been taking cycloestrogenol. And when he came in, his blood pressure, you can't really read it here, but it was like 158. And he had a very low SEVR, which is a subendocardial viability ratio. So we have this amazing machine that is a pulse wave analyzer, and it looks at the pressure generated by your cardiac system. So he went from that 160 down to like 110 within 4 years, which is typically not what we see at the age of 77 to 81. And what's more is his SEVR, or his subendocardial viability, improved markedly. here's Carl, who for 30 years has been pitching baseball, and he actually had a complication, one of the few complications of TA. He got dizzy standing up, and that's because the two drugs he was on were too much after his arteries had softened and become more efficient. So when he stood up, he would get orthostatically hypotensive. His blood pressure was like 90 over 40. So I guess that could be considered a complication, but of course he just adjusted his drugs and took less. Finally, there's an increased SEVR. There's a patient of mine who's 75 who initially had SEVR, which was below red, below critical, and it improved like 30%. He had a heart attack. He didn't even realize he had a heart attack. It's proven by enzymes. And so I believe that helped him survive. Excuse me. I'm going to go faster then. The important thing with cancer and AIDS is we generally see a lower incidence of cancer. It's hard to know, but I think it's important to remind ourselves that Jimmy Carter, our former president, had cancer of the brain, metastatic melanoma, and it was cured because his CD8 killers, by taking a monoclonal immunotherapy, there's apparently a signal that tells those CD8s to die. And if you block that die signal, his own immune system cured him of his metastatic brain cancer a couple of months ago. One of my ironically, my friend, his dad had brain cancer a couple years later. This is his brain before, and he died 2 years, 3 years later without any brain cancer. It was completely clear. He died because the doctors felt they shouldn't treat his prostate because he'd be dead of brain cancer. And unfortunately, he died of prostate cancer, which was arguably curable. We see a better resistance to cold and flus, and we see no general increase in autoimmune disease. So finally, I believe that aging and cancer are stem cell diseases, and they're related to AIDS, which means an acquired immune deficiency. So as we get older, we acquire immune deficiency because our blank keys are running out. I won't belabor the point here. This HeLa karyotype or chromosomes is happening in all your cells. If it happens in your brain, you could get brain cancer. If it happens in your pancreas, you could get pancreatic cancer. And so this diagram I came up with shows what we as doctors typically worry about. Cancer is diagnosed, surgery, radiation, chemo. Of course, this is like a nuclear bomb destroying everything. What we don't worry about is what's under the surface, what leads to the cancer. And what we see here, I believe, if we have telomere erosion in all these cells, if we can prevent that with telomerase activation, we have less problems. Then we have P53, which is charged with destroying the cell. That's an important part. And then we have these natural killers and cytotoxic cells, like the ones that cured cancer. In this last section, I just want to go to the literature. Now, a lot of people don't believe in what they haven't seen. They say, well, this is Dr. Park. There are 18,000, maybe more articles. So let's look at some of them. As we go through literature, babies born to moms with sleep apnea have shorter telomeres. Snoring is associated with short telomeres. People who sleep less have shorter telomeres, and with poor quality, again, shorter telomeres. And it's important to realize the critical nature of sleep. There's so much mysterious healing that happens, and realize that every aspect of sleep function deteriorates as we get older. Here are four studies looking at telomeres and exercise. Current physical activity confers a higher telomerase or higher telomere length. Ultramarathoners are supposedly 16 years longer in their telomeres, and increased oxygen capacity is a predictor of leukocyte telomere length. Finally, people who overexercise and get fatigued muscles, they have these burnt out shortened telomeres. In the literature, the skin was shown to be shorter telomere containing as we get older. The mice, again, given telomerase activation, showed younger coats. DiPinno at Harvard showed that. And what we see from the osteoporosis literature is that older osteoporotic women have shorter telomeres in their bones. This interesting study just shows that if you look at the wild type, they can copy a lot and they have low telomere damage. If you introduce the Werner helicase mutation, which is the DNA winding, they don't have a lot of telomere damage, but they can't copy. then you introduce the mutation in telomerase key, TERC, and they can't copy, and they start to get mutations. If you do both, you're really in bad trouble. Okay, no time to breathe here, but we can watch Deborah. She's 62, and she's having fun. And again, she's a private person, but she wanted me to share this with the couple thousand people on my email list, because she believes that this is helping her, and she wants other people to consider. And it's not that you can't get sick or get cancer. Her husband, Harold, is 90-something, and he's the inventor of the geosynchronous satellite. He just had a stroke, but he's getting better. But again, Harold can also stand on one arm like a yogi. It's really amazing. So they're both athletes, and they're both living. She's 62, he's 91. And again, I don't know if I can illustrate this, but it's like, finally, the literature, the circulation, it proves what I'm trying to tell you, is that you look at the age-related endothelial problems, you look at the actual cells from the vessels in old people, they have all these weird mutations. That's what we're seeing. When you look at the surgical specimens of aneurysms from the aorta, we see increased levels of mutations and lower levels of telomere expression. And finally, this other study from the journal Hypertension in 2014 said the mean telomere length was not important. What was important is how many critically uncapped telomeres you had, and that's what was associated with high blood pressure. We see in this beautiful study, when you activate telomerase, what you get is a higher NOS activity. NOS protects the vessels from oxidative damage and helps their viability. If you give a telomerase inhibitor, TRFDN, what you see is the NOS activity goes down. Now, if you give telomerase reactivation to these cells, not only do they divide 48 population doublings, just like the senescent cells, but what you don't appreciate is that the senescent cells are acting badly. They don't have the high NOS activity. So again, we see repeatedly that what's going on is the telomerase activity is what's mediating the benefit. Finally, on this study with exercise, they had smooth muscle cells in 1% oxygen, not what we're breathing, 21%, and they found that the hypoxia was actually what caused, through telomerase activation, the smooth muscle to divide over and over again. And they know this because they gave a weak telomerase activator and the cells divided less, and they gave a strong telomerase activator and it was even worse. This just speaks to a large study, 5,000 patients with chronic kidney disease, and after they adjusted for everything they could, they found again, what we're seeing is that coronary artery disease, heart attacks, surgery of these two types, aortic and carotid, all associated with shortening telomeres. This important concept is the stem cell theory of cancer. Now, people are worried because 85% of cancers express telomerase, but I would submit that it's not because they turn it on like a dedifferentiation, like an induced pluripotent stem cell. It's more like Batman and Superman. Let me explain. Batman is special. He saw his parents die. He's a rich billionaire. He's got a different origin story. But Superman is nothing special. Everybody from his planet is a superhero. So I believe that now people are starting to understand the orthodox cancer theory, which is that cancer arises in already immortal stem cells. And I think that's the difference. And we have to realize that we may have gotten cancer millions or billions of times already. It may have been cured, or even the definition of cancer is very suspect. Is it contact inhibition? Is it loss of apoptotic oncogenes? It's not one thing. The biggest study looking at cancer was from the Journal of American Medical Association, and it showed that the shorter the telomeres, the higher the risk of getting cancer and the higher the risk of dying from it. And finally, this speaks to my whole theory of AIDS and aging. I think that aging is AIDS. AIDS is a form of aging. And this, if you want to learn more about this, the citation from Doc and Efros really states it very clearly, that we lose these CD28 cells, and that's what's causing us to get old. Finally, the literature, there's one big problem, which is that it's easy to check blood leukocytes, just like this guy can check his tire pressure. It's right there. But this study from physiologic research looked at 11 different human organs and compared it with the blood, the easy ones to check, and said there wasn't that great correlation. So we have to understand that of these 18,000 articles, the majority, they got lazy and they just tested blood. The ones I quoted to you, they tested the actual tissue of interest, which is more important. So my final cell is what I call the Redenbacher effect, which is that maybe when you cook popcorn, it seems like nothing happens for 2 minutes, and then all of a sudden all the popcorn goes off. Well, just so, all our stem cells are aging, and they're all, it seems like we get sick all at once, but maybe it's because they've been aging that whole time, and maybe, just maybe, it's because they all come from the same pool of resources, the mesenchymal stem cells. So the reason why we get all these diseases, we get older, is because our blank keys are crappy, and they're gone. If you want to measure telomeres, please watch my video, Telomeres, the Ultimate Biomarker. But in general, healthy things are things that make your telomerase activity higher, like sleep, meditation. I believe that after we clear these telomeres, we can get younger and stay healthier. This is my life length test. I'm off the charts, 14,100 in telomere median length, and only 1%. It should be something like 15%. Only 1% are less than 3,000. So I could live hundreds of years. My telomeres are literally longer than a fetus. What is the future of what we're doing? This lady I interviewed introduced through adenovirus-associated vector 2 or 3 extra genes copies of telomeres. That may be one way to go, although I don't know. It's kind of indiscriminate. Finally, there's other stronger telomerase activators, but who knows if their safety profile is going to be as good. It's like artificial water for cleaning, like bleach and hydrochloric acid are better cleansers, but are they really as safe? I think a future of adult stem cell banking is important. We have the best copy of me, Ed Park, 48 years old. I need to get that frozen, and then 20 years from now I can reuse that. And finally, lifestyle, as I'll be talking about in my book, is very important. So I'd like to just close by saying medical science is reductionist. There's no way that Uranus turning on its side can explain our solar system. There's no way that this angiotensin receptor blocker explains why the blood pressure does what it does. In fact, my blood pressure theory is that it's not a disease, it's an adaptation to poor perfusion. So what we have is like this moment on this song is noise. We focus because we can monetize, we can publish, we can be experts on our one little pathway. But what our bodies really are is a jazz band. And that little sampling doesn't explain how these musicians interact. It's improvisation, it's a song. So when we talk about aging and disease, I believe there is this one central principle, and it all goes back to telomere shortening. And what we need to do is find ways to enhance our flow, our lokahi, our balance. So if you're going to do this, keep your keys young, meditate, exercise, eat well, and think of it in terms of a car. I mean, if you had a $50 million Ferrari, you wouldn't change the oil at 50,000 miles. You'd change it every 2,000 miles. Nothing would be too good for your baby. Well, you're only given one body, one car. You want to keep it healthy, not in your 50s, but in your 20s or earlier. So again, I'm very cognizant. My work is like Jane Goodall. I'm looking at chimps. I'm writing stuff down. This is not science per se. It's more like law. I'm just writing down cases and collecting things. So what we really need are big studies, big money to validate what's going on here. And hopefully that'll come soon. I'd like to remind everybody here that we're all lucky. We had a 1 in 22 million chance of making it to the egg, and we all did. So, you know, whether your parents came from North Korea or, you know, whether you were sick and stressed out, you know, I'm sure if you asked my dad to be or not to be, this is shortly after he was diagnosed, he'd want to be. And so we're all here for a reason. It's not meaningless, and we're all here to live a long and healthy life. And the answer is, how long do you want to live? As long as you're healthy. How long is that? Well, as long as we can keep our telomerase active. This is the castle where Hamlet was based in Denmark. And so I'd just like to thank Dr. Lucia Chung. I was very lucky that she came and found me at the convention we were at, and I thank the Korean Anti-Aging Association as well. Please sign up at my blog and for my YouTube videos, and if you want to join us for dinner tonight. I do have a few books I can give out and sign as well. I'm also writing a new book, and if anybody's interested, that'll be called The Telomere Miracle, and the Korean rights are available to that. So, thank you very much, 여러분들. 감사합니다. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm sorry it was so slow and then fast. So, does anybody have a question? I don't know if we have time.
Yeah, thank you very much for keeping time, but looks like there's lunch right after this, but because we started about 5 minutes late, and looking at their eyes, looks like there will be many questions. 질문 있으신 분들은 좀 질문해 주시면 감사하겠습니다. 혹시 저 영어가 안 되시면 그냥 우리말로 하셔도 됩니다. 제가 질문을 바꿔드리겠습니다. 네, 선생님.
It's very interesting. Thank you for your wonderful lecture.
Thank you.
The question for you, I will use Korean because it's hard to express my what I think.
네, 변하신 대로 말씀하세요. Okay.
그 아주 흥미로운 주제인데요. 그 우리가 하는 그 저 운동, 엑서사이즈가 얼마나 이 텔로메르 액티베이트에 영향을 주는지 하고요. 또 한 가지는 그 자 일종의 어떤 그 우주 전체 만물의 이론처럼 한 가지 이론으로서 다 설명할 수 있다라는 걸 굉장히 흥미로운데 그걸 제가 정확히 다 이해는 못했어요. 그래서 그걸 조금 보충 설명을 좀 해주시고요.
Okay. Yeah. The first question is, how would exercise influence telomere length? The second one, it looks like your issue here is that we should be looking at the one that would be the basis of everything, every disease, and how would that fit to the most of the diseases that we are facing right now?
Yeah, it's a good question. You know, exercise is helpful because it's destructive, right? It destroys muscle. It needs to be rebuilt. So there's always a yin-yang. And again, we have that fatigue muscle syndrome. If you only destroy and don't give it a chance to recover, then it's not good. So it appears that exercise, especially after 40, is very important to maintaining telomere length. Also, weight training is very important for people in their 50s and 60s. But it's probably the destruction, the overcopying, and then the apoptosis and replacement. So again, birth comes from death, right? We need to destroy stuff to rebuild it and secrete those hormones. With regard to the one disease idea, it's an oversimplification. Certainly there are genetic predispositions, there's viruses, there's prions, there's x-rays. You can get disease from many different ways. What I'm suggesting is that you can get all of them from this one reason. There are other reasons, but this is a sufficient explanation for every single disease, because what is it doing? It's taking the chromosomes, chopping them up, like pa, you know, like onions. So this is enough to explain all of disease. Does it explain all of disease? No. You can get mutations from chemicals, viruses, yada, yada, yada. But this is why we see the association of 20,000 articles and telomere shortening. And the problem with measuring the mean telomeres is that, look, if you measure the mean telomere of Henrietta Lacks, you get a big number and you say, ah, there's no relationship between cancer. Our understanding is already beyond that. We understand that mean telomere length is not important. It's like the length of a hair on a homeless person. You know, it's going to grow. What's important is how many critically short telomeres we have. And that's really what I'm suggesting, is that you get to all these different diseases because of one process. I hope that answers your question.
The only available information that has helped us to live longer is low-calorie diet. And does low-calorie diet influence the telomerase activity?
You know, there's different feelings on low caloric restriction. It puts the cell into crisis, and it seems to turn on these pathways. But again, it's sort of like if you play guitar, do taekwondo, you get a callus on your hand. Do you really want your cells in crisis in switching into a preserved, hardened mode? You know, better to have a high-calorie diet and have all your cells still function well. But yeah, there is a certain crisis mode that's triggered through the sirtuin pathways. But again, my personal bias is that I'd rather eat a lot and exercise a lot, or not at all, than have to starve myself. But it is interesting that there is this balance in life. It's true. If you give cells hypoxia, then they thrive. Right? So just like with people, if you starve cells, then they become tougher. So it's complicated. But yeah, caloric restriction is a very popular theory, as is mitochondrial dysfunction.
How about you mentioned about hypoxia being a triggering factor that increases telomerase activity. And does smoker have, or CO intoxication? They are the ones who are hypoxic. Well, are you talking about the cell hypoxia or the person being hypoxic?
Great question. I just blogged about this, and if you do subscribe to my blog, you'll wonder, is he kidding? But I just blogged about the oldest modern woman, Jean Clement, smoked for 117 out of 124 years, 2 cigarettes a day. I mean, maybe her vessels were healthier because she underwent intermittent hypoxia with CO poisoning. You know, that's a crazy thought, but then again, maybe the fact that you do aerobic exercise, it causes transient hypoxia, that's making your arteries stronger. So there's a lot we don't understand. People like simple explanation, but it's not always simple.
Yeah, 질문하시죠.
So I'm Dr. Che from the Wontuan Army Hospital in Seoul. So I have two questions for you. Number one, is this product still in research, or is this FDA approved? Number two, is there any study that you apply this product to patients who have progeria that might delay their aging process? So, top
one. Yeah, I understand. Great question. They should have done the progeria study a long time ago. With regard to FDA approval, it is not FDA approval seeking. Actually, the company wants a broader use by saying, aging is not a disease. Therefore, don't, you know, talk to us about disease. As long as they don't make any specific claims, and as long as my videos say, I'm not saying this cured is high blood pressure, but it's interesting, isn't it? I don't make disease claims. They leave it alone because it's a natural product. They have been in, I think, 7 months into the Korean FDA approval process. So they have their safety, mutagenesis, efficacy, all that stuff. So what the Korean FDA considers it to be, whether a drug or a nutraceutical, I don't know. But presumably it will be approved here as some kind of legal use substance.
Would you briefly give us your information about how the TA65 has a link between telomerase activity and the diseases that you have experienced? Do they really have shortened the lengthened the telomere or given the telomerase activity?
Yeah, I've measured telomeres a lot in myself and my patients, you know, probably hundreds of measurements, and there's different methodologies, but I do believe that in general the trend is towards lengthening. But initially, interestingly, there is a shortening, I believe, that happens in a lot of patients. As what happens is a lot of the senescent cells have overgrown some of their telomeres for a while. So in more cases than not, in the first 6 months of this radical apoptosis, my experience is that like 7 out of 10 people get a shortened telomeres because a lot of the overgrown aberrant cells go away. But then if you stay on it for a year or two, the trend tends to be longer, and indeed the trend has been longer for me as well. But I'm just relieved. Every time I check my telomeres, I'm scared because I don't want it to be like 18,000, because then I have to lose the benefit of what I'm doing for my daily lifestyle. And I don't want it to be too long or too short. So just like those bristlecone pines, it's not getting ridiculously, dangerously long.
Okay. If you go back to the slide 34.
Yes.
You have indicated the changes of the person who has been taking this product. That is correct?
This is an aggregate of 7,000 person years.
Yes, so who may have had some experience with the product, right?
But you know, the reporting bias is so bad. Like, if people get a complication, are they really going to report it?
Right.
But you know, there doesn't be a cluster of adverse effects.
Right.
Like,
so
not
my,
everybody
my
gets
question
blindness or
is,
whatever.
If the person has changes in blood sugar and the serum insulin and all these, they may influence the telomerase activity as well.
Yeah, I think it's really, exactly, it's fundamental. I mean, in all classes of cells, it's helping them behave younger.
Right.
In all classes of cells, it's helping them die if they're bad and they need to die.
Right.
So the real question is, yeah, it's making them younger, it's making them better. Do you have anything to replace it with? Do you still have a good copy of your mesenchymal stem cells, your blank keys? That's the key. It's not the constant death and turnover. It's do you have a good copy of your original software? And that's how we're going to live to be 200, 300, 400 years. We freeze, like many of your kids, if they were born recently, they may have had cord blood frozen, the best. That's the original copy of your software.
Yes, one more question.
Yeah. Hi, Eddie. So it was a fabulous talk.
Thank you.
The question is that, you know, I start to take TA65, and the concern is whether there is a predisposition to risk of increased cancer taking this for a long time by increasing telomerase activity.
Yeah.
That's the question.
It's a great question. And again, I blogged about this. You know, it's not that you can't get cancer. I keep track of who gets cancer, that tells me. But the number is lower than the baseline risk of cancer. If you look at that JAMA study of 10 years, 11% of these old people got cancer. My median age is in the 70s for my patients. I've had maybe 11 cancers reported, and I don't know if any of them, one has been fatal. So it's like you get your car washed beautifully. It doesn't mean a bird can't, you know, poop on it. You are going to get cancer. How will you handle it? I mean, one of my patients he's patient number 6. He emailed me a month ago, said, "Doc, I got colon cancer." I said, "Oh my God, what are you going to do?" He continues to take TA65. He did a surgery. Thank God the doctors thought he was too old to take chemo. His CEA is 1.3.
But instinctively, you know, if the patient has occult underlying cancer and you're increasing telomerase activity, that may, you know, continue to have the cancer cells grow. And I think that's the concern of this.
I think that is a concern. And I think you need to be aware that it could make those cancer cells that are occult be more easily diagnosed and treatable. And that's been my anecdotal experience. But that's a great point. But, you know, it's like if you have a hostage situation. Let's say this is a hostage situation. Do you put everyone to sleep by poisoning us with gas, or do you send in guns and let the good guys outnumber the bad guys? Our current cancer therapy is poisoning everyone. And we all know that chemotherapy is a horrible mutagen, so you're setting up more business down the line for further cancers. How much better is it to do what they did to Carter and block the poison that the cancer was tricking the system with? That guy cleared his brain cancer himself. They say, "Well, we'll sell you a drug." No, what you did was you blocked the signal that the cancer was using to shut down his immune system. He cleared it himself. And it's very arguable and probably true that we've all had cancer millions or billions of times already.
Theoretically, it would be unethical to try your product to terminal cancer patient. Would you be trying?
Well,
because
you know, when you use a word like
there's a volunteer,
when you use a word like unethical, it's tough because you know we all speak from a medical viewpoint, and entire establishment of medicine is unethical if you think about it. I mean, we force people into taking chemotherapy knowing it won't help their survival.
Right.
And then we make money off of it. I mean, it's totally unethical. But yeah, when viewed from the perspective of standard of care, mm-hmm. yes. Yes. When viewed as a compassionate Hail Mary, you know, my very first podcast was these women that were forsaken, just given up, and they had incredible cures. But again, just to give you an example, one lady had metastatic lung to the brain. It cleared after taking TA65, and I said to her, Jackie, she's a nurse, you have to find a doctor to take out your primary. And she said, none of them will touch me. They all think I'm dead. Same with my friend, Mr. Kim. They won't cure my prostate because they think I'm dead. But this is the problem. Doctors are asleep. We're like zombie robots. I mean, we're really executioners. So this Jackie couldn't get anyone to take out her primary. Think of it like a dandelion. I don't know how to say that in Korea. You're 6 months without the 3-centimeter met or 4-centimeter met in your brain. Get rid of the primary lung cancer. They didn't, and, you know, she died of multiple mets. So we're part of the big problem is that we right. trust too much. We believe orthodoxy, even though orthodoxy is highly unethical.
혹시 더 질문하실 분들 계십니까? 예.
Thank you, doctor, for your interesting presentation. Excuse my ignorance, but what is the actual protocol that you use to your patients? Does the patient have to get some injection or take the medicine daily?
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't explain. It's a single molecule extract in the form of a capsule, so it's taken orally.
Okay, and you've mentioned like 60,000 US dollars for?
It can vary. It's 8,000 a year down to 2,000 a year. Or, you know, for young people, I tell them to take it like aspirin. Just keep a bottle. If you have a stressful day, you just save it, you know.
What is the mean duration that you search for the changes of telomerase or telomere?
Oh, yeah. It's hard to say. But I know that it's more like a clinical effect. You can feel it right away from the sleep. You know if it's working. In most people, 8 out of 10 people, they'll report subjectively very different kinds of sleep. And also middle of the night awakenings are frequent. So that's a good way to gauge how high the dose should go and things like that.
또 질문하실 분?
저는 질문은 아니고요. 약간 부연 설명을 드리려고 제가 저기 했는데 텔로메어 랭스 재는 게 지금 에드바게 하는 거는 피쉬 방법으로 해서 다른 방법으로 재고 있기 때문에 지금 우리나라에서 현재 잴 수 있는 거는 PCR 방법으로 해서 재서 민 랭스만 보거든요. 그래서 본인이 하는 건 이제 액티비티하고 길이가 얼마나 길어졌는지까지 같이 보는데 아직 우리나라에서는 그렇게 안 하고 민 랭스만 봐서 좀 검사하는 방법이 틀립니다. 그래서 우리나라에도 그걸 저기 들여오기 위해서 여러 군데 좀 협상을 하고 있는데 아직 잘 안 되고 있어요. 그냥 다른 강의 들으시는 분들을 위해서 부연 설명 조금 드렸습니다.
네, 감사합니다. 장시간 아주 좀 새로운 분야에 대한 이야기를 해주셔서 너무 감사드리고요. 점심 맛있게 드시고 그 다음 아마 잘 연결해서 잘 들으시면 감사하겠습니다. Thank you very much for your wonderful presentation.